mentioned that after the question answer session, Zamikan will come and we can deliver the packs to our guests. And after that, we'll have a clear demonstration, and then after that, we'll have the food. So just a reminder of the program. Some very nice, really interesting questions. Some I'm quite, I think I understand, others I'm not sure if I understand because they're too brief. Is Sufism heresy? Sufism, in case some of you don't know, it's a tradition within Islam of renouncing extra pleasures of the world. That's essentially what it is. When you talk about Sufism, there's two different types of Sufism. There is the type of Sufism which is closer to being, it's very close to Islam. It's part of Islam. It does not contradict the Islamic teachings. And those Sufis call themselves Muslims, and they practice Islam. They don't give up on the prayer, they fast. They give their obligatory charity. They hold all the beliefs which are mentioned. And then at the same time, there are Sufis, especially in the West, who say that it's just a mysticism. It is pure spirituality. To the point that there are some organizations in the West, Sufi organizations, who are more into chanting and spiritual exercises, and they say that you do not even have to be a Muslim to be a Sufi. So obviously, you know, they don't represent Islam, that strand of Sufism. But in general, Sufism is something which is within the tradition and within the fold of Islam in general. Okay, so that's one. Different type of a question. How to handle Fox News propaganda? I think I almost know who would ask me this question. actually, this is a very good question. It's actually quite close to my heart. Here is the thing. Where change takes place is when the silent majority actually says, you know what, these people are human beings. They're made of flesh and blood. And I may not necessarily agree with everything they believe or the way they do things, but nevertheless, they are human beings. And I can respect them and I can live with them as my neighbors. They treat me with respect and I treat them with respect. And when they are being demonized, and when things are being said about this group of people which they just don't subscribe to, then what role can I play to make a change? And there's actually another question, which was, what can non-Muslims, especially Christians, do to make Muslims feel more comfortable practicing their faith? Or how can we combat Islamophobia? So these are two really good questions. I think in different segments of the society, there has to be greater awareness of the teachings of Islam, both one-on-one relationships. But above all, when you see, you know, the media rules, that's just the reality of it. More people you know, are influenced by it. Media, the airwaves reach more people, a greater audience, and is more effective. That's just the reality of it. There is money, there is advertising, marketing. There's a whole industry over there. The way it changes is when people speak up. When they call Bill O'Reilly and say this is not true. And they actually make that, you know, a few second phone call, 1 minute phone call. Or they ask their Muslim friends, this was said about you by the talk show host, is it true? Do you actually believe this? Like I have, you know, somebody over here asking some questions. They actually believe this? Or is this just being a lie which is being attributed to you? And they call these people back and say, you know, this is not acceptable. Islamophobia is not acceptable. Just like anti-Semitism is not acceptable. Many other types of hatred are not acceptable. Racism is not acceptable. That's what America is all about. That's why I decided to come to this country. Because these are the American values which I came over here when I was very young. Many years ago. I'm not that. These are the American values. This is what makes us Americans. We are American Muslims. That's who we are. And these are the values which we hold dear to our heart. And we would really like to see these values being practiced, not just something which is talked about, but when it comes to the other, and the other being us, we are the demons. Because there is a whole industry which feeds on demonizing this, the fear industry. You're cutting off people. You're cutting off people. You're creating monsters when necessarily there are no monsters. So once again, as I said, if we can call up, if we can write, if there is a campaign going on, then we, you know, participate in that campaign and add our voice, whether it's the pulpit of the church, or whether it's the Congress, or the state House of Representatives, any at any forum where we can create an environment of tolerance, it will go a long way. And we Muslims need to do our part as well. And this small effort is just one small step towards that, us trying to do whatever little we can do. What happens to women who do not wear hijab? They don't get flogged, they don't get stoned to death, they live their lives, that's a decision they make, that's where they are in their spiritual journey, that's where they are in their spiritual journey. I talk to them all the time, they talk to me all the time. I won't point them out, but that's their decision. That's what they have chosen to do at this point in their life. Could there be another prophet after Muhammad, according to Islamic teachings? No. According to the orthodox Islamic teachings, Muhammad is the final prophet of God. You might say, why? Why? Why would that make sense? Why him? Why does the line of prophets stops at him? The answer is very simple. The revelation, according to the Muslim teaching, okay, I speak on my behalf of my faith. According to the Muslim teaching, according to the Islamic faith, the scripture which he brought is preserved. The book which he brought is actually preserved. And his teachings, which are known as the Sunnah, I did not get into those, you know, a lot of that Arabic jargon, you know, technical words, is preserved. To give you an example of the preservation of the Quran, it was revealed in Arabic. People, it's a living language of at least 150 million people today. The language never died. And it is a book which is memorized by thousands of people all over the globe in Arabic. I'm not trying to say this to boast, but my daughter is one of them. She has the whole book memorized in Arabic. I'm not saying this to boast. I'm just telling you that it's not like these people live, you know, just in like on Mars or something. No, there are people who memorize the whole book as a sign of piety and devotion, even here. In MSA, Bilal, for those of you who know the MSA of Bradley University, he has also memorized the entire Quran. And there are many other people. And there is a built-in system where the book is reviewed to keep it fresh in the memory every year. So for instance, this year, we will have a person who has memorized the Quran who will come and lead us in the month of Ramadan, in the prayers. So every day, most of these people, most of the Muslims over here, they'll come here and they'll pray an extra hour, hour and a half, every day in the evening. And the whole Quran will be recited in Arabic from memory. Okay. So my point is that at least from our perspective, this is how we view things, this is our belief, is the sources of religion, the revelation, the original sources, what it was revealed, it has been preserved. So in other words, from our perspective, whatever mankind needs on their spiritual journey towards God, they possess. They have it in their possession. They can find the way to God through Islam and our world maybe. In Islam, will we know one another in heaven? Yes, we will. The Islamic heaven is not only a spiritual heaven, it is a physical and spiritual heaven. And likewise, other things. What are the Islamic teachings about the afterlife? Is there heaven, hell, or reincarnation? There is no teaching in Islam of reincarnation. Islam does not teach reincarnation. It does teach about the existence of heaven and hell. And as I have mentioned, that this is one of the fundamental articles of belief of Muslims. Every person will be judged based on their acceptance or rejection of belief, and if they lived up to the standards of the true faith of God. This will be the standard which will be used according to Muslims for judgment and afterlife. But there is heaven and there is hell, and a very vivid description of heaven and hell. What is the stand on divorce? not sure if I completely understand this question. Divorce is something which is allowed in Islam, but it is not something, you know, where in some faith traditions they call it an annulment, or they say, you know, that, well, you were not really married to begin with, that's how they end the marriage. So it's not like that. There is a marriage, and that marriage is not a sacrament, but rather a contract between two parties, the bride and the groom, which come with certain rights and responsibilities. And if at some point they feel, for whatever reasons, they cannot continue, they split. It is not something frowned upon. What is frowned upon is mistreatment. What is frowned upon is when the two parties cannot give each other their due rights and cannot treat each other with respect. When they cannot do that, they cannot do that. They can move away if they so decide. But it is not the ideal situation. If they can work out their differences, that's the best route to go. It should not be the first course of action. And there is a lot of details about divorce and how Islamic divorce works, which I don't think most people would be interested in. How does Islam deal with the apparent conflict between the belief in a God who created and modern science which teaches the universe originated with no intelligence guiding it? I'm not sure what is the scientific background of the person asking this question. I myself studied physics at a graduate level. I used to be an atheist myself. This was again longer. This was before I even came to America. I was very impressed by Stephen Hawking, Brief History of Time. I don't know if you know about that book or not. I thought he was just the smartest person, you know, who ever lived on the planet after Einstein. And I went to Texas, and over there I met with a few Nobel laureates who I worshipped at that point. One of them was Steven Weinberg, and the other was Professor Sudarshan, who was nominated for the Nobel Prize 2 or 3 times but never won it. So once I was having a discussion with Professor Sudarshan, because my reason for studying physics was to either find God or to say that there is no God. All of this is just fake. So I asked Dr. Sudarshan, he's from India, by the way. He has many books written, you know, common for the layman, which are available in the market also. I asked him that Stephen Hawking says that the universe is a closed system which created itself. What do you say about that? I mean, you know, quantum dynamics is your specialty. Relativity is your specialty. You know, this is how your brain functions. What do you think about this? He said, who created the system? He said, who created this closed system to begin with? He said, people don't know, no one was there. So this is, I'm talking about someone who, and there's a very good book, Bios, Cosmos, Theos. I think that's the name. If you search it on Amazon, you will find a book close to this name, Bios, Cosmos, Theos. It talks about biology, it talks about cosmology, and it talks about theology, belief in God. What these guys did is they went to the guys who discovered the DNA, they went to the top Nobel laureates in all different fields, whether it's biology, whether it's chemistry, whether it's physics, anything. And they asked them, do you believe in God? It's a simple question, it's non-technical. Do you believe in God? Yes? Why? No? Why? What do you say about evolution? Do you believe it? Do you not believe it? I would suggest you read that book. Because many of those people in there are not believers, and there are some who are believers. Try to get that book and read it. There is not necessarily conflict between religious belief and scientific discoveries. There is not necessarily a conflict. The conflict exists sometimes when we take our own understanding of science to be the ultimate judge, which it is not. Do Muslims decide individually who to donate for charitable giving? There are two types of charity in Islam. There is that which is required. Muslims don't decide who to give it to. It's 8 categories, they are specified in the Quran. That's who you have to give this to. Help the poor, help the needy, person who is stranded, freeing a slave when they used to be slaves. So there are 8 ways to spend that obligatory charity on, known as zakat. That's fixed. And after that, there is other types of charity, like building this community center, supporting Islamic activities, other things. It's just charity. It's not required. People give as much or as little as they want. and they can give it to whoever they like. So that. Does the local Muslim community experience any significant prejudice in their local area? That's a good question. My good friend, Rabbi Daniel Bogart, he's in Jerusalem right now. He couldn't make it over here with his wife. He told me that he has lived in many different communities. Some of you, I'm sure, might know him. He said that he has seen more prejudice and bias against Muslims in Peoria, and I'm quoting him, than any other city in the United States that he has lived in. He was trained in Ohio, he lived in New York, and he has been in other parts of the United States as well. But we need to do our part. We need to do our part to change things, and things will change. Things will change. I still have hope in the goodness of human beings. Islam appears to have rules of conduct that are gender-based. That is very true. How is gender defined in Islam? Especially with regard to transgendered or intersex individuals. That's a good question. I'll probably try to give a brief answer, and then again, if somebody would like more details, my door is always open. I can always discuss this individually. A person who is closer to being a male is treated as a male. A person who is closer to being a female is treated as a female, as far as the rules and regulations are concerned. And let's say if there is a person, and this is very rare medically, from based on what my research is, based on what I know, if somebody is absolutely in the middle between being a male and a female, then they pick. They can pick how they would like to be treated. They can treat to be. They can choose to be treated as a male or a female. But they have they are the creation of God as well. They are to be respected as well. There's no prejudice, there is nothing like that. I'll answer this question. But I wish that... Women in Islam. Quran says that you can beat your wife. And I have a reference here also. Sharia says it's husband's right to hit his wife. I wish instead of making a statement as a factual statement, it was formulated as a question. Because that's really the spirit. That does Islam say this? Is this the teaching of Islam? The Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet of God, his wife, Aisha, says that he never hit any woman, animal or servant. He never hit any woman, animal or servant. This is in Sahih Bukhari. This is the most authentic Islamic tradition, book of traditions after the Quran. Not only this, there were some women, and this is also an authentic Islamic tradition, they came to the Prophet complaining of bad treatment from their husbands. There was like a bunch of women. They came to him saying, you know, our husband, they mistreat us. The Prophet of God said, they are not good believers. They are not good believers. They are not good believers. Mistreatment of women is not something that Islam allows or tolerates. It is not something that Islam allows or tolerates. Second question is, why a daughter should get half of a son after death? Once again, the assumption made over here is that this is what it is. This is a very common question which is raised by, it's based on prejudice which goes back to a long time, based on missionary writings and stuff. It's not true. It is not true. There's a scholar from Egypt. His name is Dr. Salah Sultan. He resides in Cleveland. He has written a book in English. I believe you can order it from his personal website. The Islamic laws of inheritance are very complicated and very detailed. There are more than 20 instances, which you can find in his book, and I'm giving you the reference, in Islamic law, where a woman inherits more than a man. Where a woman inherits more than a man. And there are other instances where a woman inherits equal to a man. And of course, there are other instances where a woman inherits a fraction of a man. The point being a female, being a woman, does not mean just being a woman, she doesn't get. She's always treated as a half, or as she always gets half of the portion of the inheritance from her father or her family members or her husband or whatever. Can a man leave Islam without being punished? You're not in the 80s, right? You don't have the Salman Rushdie fatwa, right? I'm not from Iran. We are not going around over here chasing people. People leave Islam all the time. People leave Islam all the time. As a matter of fact, last night I was having a discussion with some people in my office. You know, how come some people accept Islam and then leave it? So can a man leave Islam? A man, yeah, and a woman too. No gender bias here. They leave Islam when they so choose. If women are equal to men, why do they have to sit separately in the prayer room? Women are equal to men in a spiritual sense. When it comes to rules and regulations, for instance, dress, dress is one of them, there are certain differences. Islam teaches a greater amount of modesty. Hijab is an expression to a Muslim of modesty, not of oppression. It is not a message to be sent that, you know, I am half or I'm not there. It's an expression of modesty. That's how we view it, at least. And the least I would expect is that people respect that. You know, okay, I can accept that, I can take that. I can live with that, that's your choice. Just like if you say in America, you know, one can take off her clothes and dress in a bikini. We accept it, right? Why can't we accept people, a woman who tries to cover herself? We can respect that too. That is tolerance. Tolerance is not to respect one and to deny the other. It is to respect both of them. After all, this country is built on the freedom of the individual. That's what this country gives us. I'm free to hold any belief I can, dress any way I can, to a certain degree, not totally. The idea of why women sit separately in the prayer room is to avoid, because you see, there are many times people who are young and their mind goes elsewhere instead of focusing on God. Sometimes even when they are married, they're having a hard day at home, they start looking elsewhere where they shouldn't be looking. To minimize the doors of temptation, to minimize that, the gender roles have been placed over there. That is the reason. That is the reason for it. That's just what it is. And I don't have to go through, you know, how many affairs and other things take place where people do. They do make mistakes and there are indiscretions. It is a result of not observing those boundaries. The purpose of this is to create well-defined boundaries within reason for the Muslim men and the Muslim women. Once again, thank you very much for listening and asking these very wonderful questions and giving me an opportunity to speak and to answer those questions to the best of my ability. If there was anything which was right and true in them, it was from God's aid and assistance, and if I made any mistake, I ask God for His forgiveness, and I also ask Him to please forgive me, because in the end of the day, I'm not perfect, I'm just a human being. So I'll invite Ryan to please come over here and to continue with the program. Once again, thank you very much for your time.